I was talking about this
Mm-hmm.
journey of Chö. So this path has two, I call the enemies, big enemies, source of demons. Tell me, what are they and how you relate to that? We need to know our demon or target, so to speak. So entire practice or Buddha's teaching has targeted to that, toward that. No. We need to know the thief, for example, to catch the thief. We need to know the enemy to kill the enemy.
Ego, self-cherishing and self-grasping are the two enemies.
What the hell? That's just a word. Let's start with, you said ego, but ego is innocent. Poor thing. Don't blame ego. Ego does not exist. In a sense, that's what Buddha said. There was no word ego in Buddhist terminology. They use that the self, the self, Atman in Sanskrit. But what's that means? What's the self grasping?
To me, the self, the grasping is the solidification and reification, the kind of, for instance, during meditation, when watching and, you know, a thought comes, then you grab onto it and you go with it. That's grasping. And the self-cherishing part is the misunderstanding about thinking that I'm more important than anyone else. And in fact, that we're different from each other and not the same. So it's sometimes hard for me to differentiate, but I think I'm beginning to understand the difference between the two a little bit.
Yeah, so the first part, quote unquote, self-grasping part, danjin, that's a technical term, right? Sometimes translated ego clinging. I know Western language it has a limitation, but a very specific meaning. You said in a meditation, that's just one level, right? That's grasping, actually literally grasping. But in our daily life, what that means? Buddha says that's the source of suffering, one way to talk about.
I mean, in a way, it's just in daily life, it's that wanting things to be different than they are, moving the chairs around on the Titanic, as you've used that before.
To me, it was a little deeper because I see myself doing this all the time, and that is thinking that I'm real, that I'm solid, thinking that that everything is all about revolving around me. Like, and not only that, but fighting for survival for this me, this separate me, and not wanting to die, not wanting to get sick. So it's a really deep identification with being this separate self. Like I'm always acting from, you know, what's good for me first. And you know, I see that deeply. And so that's where I think it is, self-grasping.
Self-grasping, self-cherishing, a little bit mixed up. Also connected, of course. But in a sense, different. If we overcome self-grasping, you can attain nirvana, hinayana, awakening, you can say, Hinayana goal, but not Mahayana goal. For example, realization of emptiness, direct realization of emptiness is the definition of actually first stage of Bodhisattva, right? But then Arhat, like Hinayana sages or Hinayana practitioners aim for becoming Arhat, right? So Arhat can be attained through direct realization of emptiness, cutting through that self-grasping. Then Mahayana go deeper that, on the top of that, this self-cherishing. That one way to say is this innate feeling that I'm more important than others, this separate self. Really, in order to overcome that, we need this Mahayana practice, for example, tonren, exchanging self for others, equalizing oneself or others, or this extra or the further purification of obscurations. We are like a pure gold, right? That's the premise of Mahayana tantric way of viewing. But then all these obscurations covered up, right? So peeling the layer one by one, right? One layer is that self-grasping. Then actually more on the top of that, this self-cherishing thought that we need to peel off. That's the compassion and the bodhicitta comes in. That's really going for the, this great scope. The great scope is really aiming for that and the enlightenment. Enlightenment is going way beyond this freedom, liberation from samsara. But that enlightenment assume this freedom from samsara, actually byproduct. Actually, in a sense, not interested in that part. We are more interested in the suffering of others. As Mahayanist, as tantric practitioner, intense, fierce Mahayanist, right? That's the definition of tantric practitioners. We are thoroughly interested in removing the suffering of all beings. For that, we need to come to this final resultant state of awakening. Then the, in terms of the self-grasping part, the bigger picture is not about this grasping things, you know, because the language says clinging, grasping, some kind of only attachment. Kind of. Technical way to explain is whatever we superimpose, something exists. For example, your partner, that's an easy way to say it. You superimpose a good quality onto the partner, no? Or the, some political figure you hate. Superimpose the bad quality onto that person, no? Then the Buddhism is saying, there's no such a thing. No, that the essence in the, this person, this, if they have inherently in the badness or the meanness or, you know, ugliness in that person, then everybody have to view that way, no? That's not the case. So things do not inherently exist. Everything exists as a label, in other words, emptiness. So self-grasping is a kind of limitation of language, but goes both ways, you know, not only attachment and hatred or whatever cling on to. That do not inherently exist. Things exist, don't deny that. Things exist, but not inherently exist. That's the meaning of Nagarjuna. Form is emptiness, emptiness is form. So true practice is the holding both that paradox together and cut through both the self-grasping, if I use that terminology, and the self-cherishing, both together. So the essence of true practice is tonden, one way to say it. Internal true is tonden. And then deepest dimension of true is, of course, going into the deepest dimension of who and what we are. So unveiling that more and more, then come to the core, realize this core. In terms of chö, quite extreme, we bring up those debris and all these yucky stuff, fears. Actually, in a sense, we welcome fears or whatever yucky things. We don't come to settle into the with the concept or theory or bring it up, oh, everything is empty, everything is okay. No, it's not okay. Welcome whatever comes up, emotion including. Like a dancing, changing. Yeah, when we come to the more Mahayana great scope in the next Ramrim class, we can go deeper into more. Yeah, I was, again, listening to Dalai Lama. He was in the middle of his teaching about the benefit of bodhicitta. He was talking about this seva in Tibetan called the caring. This innate caring each of us carry. That's the most primal motive deep in, no matter how vicious animals or human beings are. He was talking about the benefit of that, you know. See, that helps me and helps others and makes everybody happy and so forth. Then in the middle of that, he was moving on to talking about, of course, bodhicitta and the benefit of bodhicitta, Shantideva talks about. In the middle of that, he started to cry. You know, he couldn't move forward. I watched that before too. Then I myself cried together. Then again, I watched. oh my gosh, again I moved. What's this about? Anyway, so then some audience will cry and this silence, moment of this precious beauty innate human possesses, this shared humanities, you know, suffering we share in this ocean of samsara. We know what that feels like. We know how the suffering feels like. Then we know how we can feel, how I can help, how I can help to remove this dilemma. Then now I have an opportunity. He called this universal responsibility, haksam. Then that's really motivate and bring us to this bodhicitta state. We are so fortunate we can see the embodiment of bodhicitta here on the screen, that His Holiness Dalai Lama. So anyway, so I was watching and then kind of inspired me again to talk about that. So this practice is about that. It's not about how to, you know, of course, all those things are part of it, expression of bodhicitta, but don't lose the real meaning of the practice. That's my point. That's my punchline.